Discussion on sinus node dysfunction and sinus node recovery time. Most frequent symptoms of sinus node dysfunction are syncope and presyncope. Other possible symptoms are fatigue, angina, and shortness of breath. Elderly patients may present with subtle symptoms like gastrointestinal distress or a change in mental status. Symptoms can be intermittent and documentation can be difficult at times. Marked sinus bradycardia or pause may be asymptomatic occasionally. ECG rhythm strip documenting a long pause of around 8.5 seconds. Such long pauses would indicate suppression of sinus node activity and is a manifestation of sick sinus syndrome. Non-invasive methods of investigation include ECG, 24-hour Holter monitoring, exercise testing, and autonomic testing. If symptoms are infrequent, invasive electrophysiologic testing or the use of an implantable loop recorder may be needed for documentation. Monitoring the ECG and correlating bradycardia during syncope is diagnostic of sinus node dysfunction, but this is rarely achieved from the simple ECG. If symptoms are frequent, a 24 or 48-hour ambulatory Holter monitoring is useful. It is essential to document symptoms in a diary during Holter monitoring for correlation. Futility of treating asymptomatic pauses must be borne in mind. Length of the pause has poor correlation with symptoms and prognosis. If symptoms are infrequent, a loop recorder, a home recording device, or an implantable loop recorder is needed to pick up the pauses. Pharmacologic interventions or maneuvers test reflex responses of the heart rate. Carotid sinus massage causing pauses of more than 3 seconds is considered significant. Occasionally, such pauses may occur in asymptomatic elderly individuals. Intrinsic heart rate is the heart rate during complete autonomic blockade with atropine and propranolol. Intrinsic heart rate is calculated using the formula shown here. In a case of clinical bradycardia, a low IHR suggests intrinsic sinus nodal dysfunction, while a normal IHR indicates abnormal autonomic regulation. Invasive testing is reserved for symptomatic patients whose bradycardia cannot be documented by non-invasive means. Sinus node recovery time and sinoatrial conduction time are measured, but the ability to provide a definitive diagnosis by these parameters is limited. Concomitant AV nodal disease is seen in about 17% of the patients with sinus node dysfunction. New AV conduction abnormalities develop at a rate of 2.7% per year. Derivatives of sinus node recovery time. Sinus node recovery time is measured by overdrive atrial pacing for 30 seconds and noting the time required for recovery of sinus node activity after cessation of pacing. Overdrive pacing is done at different cycle lengths in sequence. The interval from the last pace beat to the next spontaneous sinus beat is taken as the sinus node recovery time. SNRT is the longest time measured at any of the different pacing cycle lengths. If there is a subsequent longer pause, it is known as a secondary pause. When the sinus cycle length prior to pacing is subtracted from the sinus node recovery time, we get the corrected sinus node recovery time. CSNRT is usually less than 550 milliseconds. The time taken for the sinus rate to reach the rate prior to pacing is taken as the total recovery time. Total recovery time is usually less than 5 seconds. Asymptomatic bradycardia or pauses with no associated episodes of atrial fibrillation needs no treatment. In symptomatic patients with sinus nodal dysfunction and atrial fibrillation, therapy depends on whether symptoms are related to the tachycardia or bradycardia. Very long pause noted on ICU central monitor of about 8 seconds and two more pauses of around 2 seconds can be seen in the tracing. The underlying rhythm is atrial fibrillation. The pauses are followed by atrial fibrillation with fast ventricular rate. Overall, this suits a diagnosis of tachybrady syndrome and warrants a permanent pacemaker, provided a reversible cause can be excluded. Capturing such a record obviates the need for Holter monitoring in this case. Long-term anticoagulation has to be considered if the CHADS2 score is high. Pacing is useful to prevent bradycardia. Drugs known to depress sinus node function should be stopped or backup pacing will be needed. Anticoagulation should be considered for atrial fibrillation. Sinus node dysfunction is the most common indication for permanent pacemaker implantation. Atrial pacing can decrease incidence of atrial fibrillation. Symptomatic patients should be considered for dual chamber pacemaker implantation. Ventricular pacing is considered for patients with chronic atrial fibrillation. Atrial pacemaker may be enough if the AV conduction is intact. Occurrence of new AV conduction abnormalities develop at a rate of 2.7% per year and must be borne in mind while planning purely atrial pacing. Rate adaptive pacing and mode switching are important functions which could be useful.